Welcome to Steps to Life. Ask the beasts, and they will teach you. And the birds of the air, and they will tell you. Or speak to the earth, and it will teach you. And the fish of the sea will explain to you. Who among all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this?
I knew a preacher, a very well-known preacher, and he came to preach at a large church. I was in the audience, and he said, I used to preach about, talking about the Sermon on the Mount, and he preached on the Beatitudes, and he preached like a one, he says, today I'm just going to preach to you about one word in the Sermon on the Mount. That was the word salt, S-A-L-T, and that was a very interesting sermon. So there's a place for those kind of sermons where you focus in on something, but sometimes it's helpful to look at something bigger, to get more a different perspective. You see something completely different when you look at it from a different perspective. And the whole book that I want to study with you today is the book of Revelation. Now, when I was a young man, I was about 20, 21 years old, I was attending Wawa College, and I translated the whole book of Revelation from Greek into English. That was part of a class. And when you do that, you're expected to be able, when the teacher asks you, to be able to tell him the conjugation of any verb that he points out, or the declension of any substantive word, noun or adjective, anything like that. And you're also supposed to be able to explain the sentence structure. And so I did that when I was in college. And then a few years later, a year after I got married, I was at the Seventh-day Adventist Theological Seminary in Berrien Springs, Michigan. And I translated the book of Revelation again, whole book, under teacher's instruction. I thought that was easy. I'd done it already once. Discourse, easy course. And so after you've translated the whole book twice and written down the answers, I don't know if this is right or wrong, but you have a feeling that you understand something about the book. I mean, you studied it word by word by word for many, many hours. So I thought I understood something about the book. But a little over 25 years ago, my brother started preaching about the book of Revelation, that there was a certain theme in the book of Revelation. And I was already an ordained Seventh-day Adventist minister, and I had translated the whole book of Revelation twice, and I'd never seen this. And I thought, what? Well, I have checked it out. And he was right. And so we're going to look today, what is one of the major themes of the book of Revelation? Now, I don't know how I translated it twice and didn't see it, but I didn't. But after it was pointed out to me and I double-checked, I said, yes, this is the theme of the book of Revelation. And it's very exciting to me to study. I hope it's exciting to you. Let's get right into our subject. Let's pray before we begin. Father in heaven, as we're now going to open your holy book and attempt to understand it, we know that without the help of your Holy Spirit, we will not understand spiritual things. So we pray that your Spirit will teach us and open the eyes of our understanding so that we will understand what we're reading. Lord, help us to understand what we need to understand so that we will not have a great disappointment at the end of the world. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In a book the size of Revelation, if there were a series of closely related things that were mentioned close to 100 times, would you get the idea that that had something to do with the major theme of the book? One of the amazing things to me is that some of these things could be mentioned so many times, and yet I could miss it. So let's start with just number one. Let's start by talking about God's temple. Now, there are several words for the temple in the Bible. They're interchangeable. It's called God's holy place, it's called a sanctuary, and it's called a temple. All of those words talk about the same thing. And God has a temple in heaven. And this temple, or sanctuary in heaven, is the central headquarters of the universe. Everything that goes on in the whole universe is directed from this place. And in this place is the throne of God, and this is one of the major themes of the book of Revelation. In fact, it is revealed in the book of Revelation more completely and with more detail than any other book in the Bible. In fact, some Bible students have concluded that perhaps this was almost secret knowledge before the book of Revelation was written. But since the book of Revelation has been written, it's public knowledge for anybody that wants to read it and understand it. Did you know that this temple in heaven was seen by the Apostle John and was written about? He wrote about it or described it at least 15 times in the book of Revelation. He is called, seven times, it's just called the temple. A couple of times, it is called the temple of God. A couple of times, it's called His temple. It's distinctly stated in Revelation 14:10 that this is the temple that's in heaven. In fact, it is stated that this is the temple of the tabernacle of the testimony in heaven. That's in Revelation 15:5, and that is a very significant sentence. We will not take time to explain that. You'll have to study that on your own if you want to understand that sentence. But that is a very significant sentence. We're not explaining all the sentences because we're going to cover a whole book. It's the temple of the tabernacle of the testimony in heaven. Once, it's simply called the temple of heaven. Now, closely connected with this temple, in this temple in heaven, it's distinctly stated that in the book of Revelation that there is an altar. This altar is inseparably connected with the temple, and the altar also is mentioned several times in the book of Revelation, but then there's the most central item of all in this temple. What is the central focus in this temple? The central focus in the temple is the throne of God. And this is the central focus of the book of Revelation. Are you aware of the fact? I was almost ashamed that this is the case and I hadn't noticed it until somebody else pointed it out to me. Are you aware of the fact that John refers to the throne of God in the book of Revelation about 39 times. Now, this is something special for the children. If you want to do this afternoon, you take a piece of paper and go through the book of Revelation and see if you can come up with 39 times that the book of Revelation refers to the throne of God. That is the central, predominant feature of this temple. And it's constantly presented before us throughout the entire series of visions. He refers to it over and over and over again in different contexts. He calls it a throne in Revelation 4:2. He calls it the throne almost 30 times. It's called the throne of God 3 times. It's referred to as His throne, the Father's throne, and my throne, Christ's throne. And We're told specifically that this throne is in heaven, it's in the temple. But then, what's more important than the throne is who is sitting on it. And the book of Revelation tells us over and over again that God sits on this throne. This is referred to in Revelation 4, in 5, to Revelation 5, in Revelation 6, in Revelation 19, Revelation 21. It's talked about over and over again. God is sitting on this throne in the temple in heaven. It's revealed to us that around this throne there is a glorious rainbow, and this throne is surrounded by celestial assistants. How many? An innumerable company. He says, in one place he says, 10,000 times 10,000. That's 100 million plus more. So this is a big place. I thought I was in a big place last week when I was in New York City, and everywhere we drove, there's just people everywhere. And let me tell you, even New York City doesn't have 100 million people. 100 million angels is a lot. So there's a lot of assistance around this, and then point number four. This throne in the tabernacle or in the temple in heaven is the source from where there come directives that direct everything in the universe. Maybe you'd like to just read a verse or two about that. Look in Revelation 4. Revelation 4 and verse 5. It says, "And from the throne proceeded lightnings, thunderings, and voices." So, directions come out from this throne that manage everything in the universe. This is the central strategic headquarters and control room for the entire universe, not just for our galaxy, our solar system, our everything in the universe is controlled right from this place. Here's a couple other texts in Revelation that talk about the same thing. Look at Revelation 16:17. It says, "Then the seventh angel poured out his bowl into the air, and a loud voice came out of the temple of heaven from the throne, saying, 'It is done.'" When that happens, it's over. You're either saved or lost. Now, that hasn't happened yet. This hasn't happened yet. But when that happens, you're saved or lost. If you're going to be saved, you have to be saved before this happens. Look at Revelation 19:5. "Then a voice came from the throne, saying, 'Praise our God, all you His servants, and those who fear Him, both small and great.'" So the temple and the throne are inseparably connected, and they're always spoken of as being in heaven. Now, as I mentioned, and something else that is closely associated with the throne, right by it, is an altar. And this altar is referred to at least 8 times in the book of Revelation. It is twice called the golden altar. You can see that in Revelation 8:3 or Revelation 9:13. It's positioned before the throne. It's right by it. You can see that in Revelation 8:3. It's also stated as being before God, right in His presence. You can see that in Revelation 9:13. And of course, it's always also stated to be in the temple, as you can read in Revelation 11:1. Now, this altar has a fire on it, according to Revelation 8:5. We won't go into that. When Jesus, you know, we are Adventists. We are looking forward to Jesus coming back in the clouds of heaven. Do you know when Jesus is getting ready to come back to this earth? Do you know when He will come? He will come at the exact time when He receives the signal from the altar. That's what the Bible says. You want to read that? Look in Revelation 14. Revelation 14. Verse 18. Says, "And another angel came out from the altar who had power over fire, and the cried with a loud voice to him who had the sharp sickle, saying, 'Thrust in your sharp sickle and gather the clusters of the vine of the earth, for her grapes are fully ripe.'" The signal for Jesus to return, the exact signal, comes from the altar. That's a very significant place. Interesting to study. If we look at different texts in the book of Revelation, we will find that the Lamb is constantly, over and over again, mentioned in conjunction with the throne, either standing by it or in it or among it. Notice a text or two. Look in Revelation 7, verses 15 to 17. "Therefore they are before the throne of God and serve Him day and night in His temple, and He who sits on the throne will dwell among them. They shall neither hunger any more nor thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any heat. For the Lamb who is in the midst of the throne will shepherd them and lead them to living fountains of waters. and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. In this series of visions that the Apostle John has in the book of Revelation, we are taken behind the scenes where no human being can see except as God reveals it. We are taken behind the scenes to see the behind-the-scenes activities of the Godhead, which are engaged for the complete recovery of the human race. The book of Revelation is focused particularly on the events of the Christian era to the end of time and the dawn of eternity. It constitutes the climax of God's revelations to men. It closes the sacred canon. The Apostle John was shown over and over again, and he writes about it over and over again, the inmost parts of the temple of this redemptive activity, where the throne of God is, the command center for the whole universe. It's an awesome scene, and you can see as you read through the book that he is struggling to find words that are big enough and powerful enough to express what he has seen, and he can't find them, so he just uses the best words he can come up with. Now here's something for the children again. You want something to do this afternoon? Almost 20 times, in 22 chapters, almost 20 times, the Apostle John mentions and describes this momentous throne room center of the universe. Almost 20 times. You read through the book of Revelation, see if you can find it. He talks about its tremendous power, the astonishing accomplishments, the fact that this throne room has to do not just with time, but with eternity. In fact, every person who has ever lived in this world, their eternal destiny, whether for life or for death, is determined in this place. The destiny of all men and women, children, is wrapped up in this room. Everything is determined from this room. It covers the vast sweep of ages. The Apostle John is overwhelmed with what he sees. He's so overwhelmed. You can read in Revelation 19, Revelation 22. He is so overwhelmed by what he has seen that he falls down to worship the one showing it to him. The angel says, no, you can't worship me. Worship God alone. He's given a vast panorama of the great controversy from beginning to end in just a 3-chapter interface with emphasis on the final events. It begins in Revelation 12 and it goes through Revelation 14. If you want to see it, just look here in Revelation 12. You see the very beginning of the great controversy between Christ and Satan in these verses. In Revelation 12, 7 to 9, it says, and war broke out in heaven. Michael, that's Christ, and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought, but they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Now those of you that have known me for a long time know that I've been intrigued for many years with numbers, especially numbers in the Bible. And one of the interesting numbers, I've never preached a sermon on this, I can preach many sermons on this number, but one of the interesting numbers, one of the most interesting numbers in the Bible is 3. I knew you thought I was going to say 7, but 3. Many, many things in the Bible are in 3s. In fact, it's just almost unbelievable. It's overwhelming, mind-boggling. And when it says here that the devil is cast out, actually, the devil is cast out 3 times. the devil's cast out three times. And when it says the devil cast out, that has to do with all three times. The first time that the devil was cast out was just before this world was created, a little over 6,000 years ago. He was cast out. That was the first time, because of his rebellion against the government of God. But when the devil was cast out, there was a problem. He was physically cast out of heaven, but the angels in heaven, now we don't know how long they'd known each other, could have been for a million years or more, we don't know. The angels had been friends of his and they still had sympathy for him.
Do you have any relatives or friends who are in prison? Do you still have sympathy with them, even though they've done something wrong, committed a crime, and now they're in prison? Do you still have sympathy for them? Well, yes, we do. If they're part of our family, even though society has cast them into prison, we still have sympathy for them. And that's the way it was with the angels. And this great controversy went on, and the angels watched the developments. If you want to read in detail about this in the Desire of Ages, in the chapter entitled It Is Finished, she says that when Jesus died on the cross, the last sympathy that the angels of heaven had for the devil was cast out. That was the second time the devil was cast out. But the devil is going to be cast out again. You see, even though he was cast out of heaven, he was not cast out of the earth. He's not even cast out of the church yet. Every time that you sin, you demonstrate to the whole universe that you still have some sympathy for the devil. You ever thought about that? Because the Bible says, he that sins is of the devil. He's the one that originated sin. He's the one that's promoting it. He's the one that's trying to get you to do it. And any time that you sin, you demonstrate to the whole universe that you still have some sympathy for the devil. But all sympathy for the devil is going to be cast out. It's going to be so successful that in the end of the, if you want to read the last pages of the book, Great Controversy, it says there, right at the end, do you know how many of the devil's angels will support him? Not one. You know how many people of this world who are lost will support him? Not one. There's going to be a third casting out, and it's going to be complete. Good. We have the devil cast out before the creation of the world, mentioned here in Revelation 12, 7 and 9. But then you have events developing with the cooperation of church and state to persecute God's children, described in more detail in Revelation 12 and 13. And then you have it coming to an end. In chapter 14, notice in chapter 14, as soon as the three angels' messages has done its work, that's in Revelation 14, 9 to 12, then you have in verse 14, it says, then I looked and behold a white cloud, and on the cloud sat one like the Son of Man, having on his head a golden crown, and in his hand a sharp sickle. So, what have we studied so far? In the temple in heaven, there is a throne room. This is the inner sanctum of unlimited power and purpose and love and action and all redemptive activity for the human race. Centers and emanates from that place. This center of it all has an altar nearby. There are seven golden candlesticks there, described in Revelation 1:12. And the Apostle John hears, you see, the Apostle John wrote this book when he was on the Isle of Patmos. And he was there, as he says in the first chapter, on account of his testimony for the Word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. He was there on account of the Word of God. He was being persecuted. There already, when Revelation was written, the Apostle Paul, the Apostle Peter, and most of the other apostles had already been martyred, and thousands of Christians had already been martyred. In fact, Ellen White says that when the book of Revelation was written, it looked like to human vision that in a short time the Christian church was going to be destroyed. Did you know that? It looked like there wouldn't be any Christian church in a little while. But it's revealed that the time is coming when everything is going to be turned around. Notice what he has shown in about the martyrs in Revelation 6. This has been a tremendous comfort to people who have been martyred for their faith down through the ages. It says, starting in verse 9, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held, and they cried with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? And a white robe was given to each of them, and it was said to them that they should rest a little while longer, until both the number of their fellow servants and their brethren who would be killed as they were was completed. Well, what is going to be the result of that? These people that have killed the martyrs, what's going to happen to them? Well, it's told to you what's going to happen to them just a few more verses down. It says, starting in verse 14, Then the sky receded as a scroll when it is rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place. And the kings of the earth, the great men, the rich men, the commanders, the mighty men, every slave and every free man hid themselves in the caves and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, Fall on us, and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath has come, and who shall be able to stand? That will be, my dear friends, the biggest prayer meeting of all time. But nobody will be saved because of their prayers. Because then it's the day of wrath. It's too late to be saved then. Like it was in the days of Noah. There was a time when the whole world believed Noah. But it was too late. There is going to come a time, friends, when the whole world will know that the Bible is true. There's going to come a time when the whole world will know who the Lord of Lords is and who the King of Kings is. There's coming a time when the whole world will believe that the Christian religion is true. There's coming a time when there won't be any atheists left in the world. There won't be any infidels or unbelievers. That he'll be too late to be saved. Because the Bible says, now is the time of salvation. Now is the accepted time. When the Holy Spirit is speaking to your conscience and saying, this is the way to go. And it's up to you to say yes or no. You see, God doesn't take people with a club and force them into doing what's right. He says in the book of Revelation, whosoever will. That's in the last chapter. In other words, by the way, you know how you can translate that? Whoever wants to. That's another way you can translate that Greek verb. Whoever wants to. Do you want to? But John has also shown that in spite of the fact that this is what happens to those that persecute, to those that kill the martyrs and all those people, he also sees something very exciting in chapter 7. He sees that there is an innumerable company from this world that will eventually be with God in the temple in heaven. Notice what it says starting in verse 15. It says, Therefore they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will dwell among them. How many are these people? Look at verse 9. After these things I looked, and behold, a great multitude which no one could number, of all nations, tribes, people, and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palm branches in their hands. Well, I want to ask you a question quickly. You ready? Are you going to be in that number? My friend, it's up to you. Not up to me. It's not up to your husband or your wife or your children or your parents. It's up to you. I can't save you. Only Jesus can save you. I can appeal to you to surrender your life to His sovereignty, to follow Him and to obey Him. I can appeal to you. Paul says, we persuade men. I can try to persuade you to do it by showing you the advantages.
But the decision is up to you. You are the one that is going to decide your eternal destiny. You're the one. You're the one. It's not your husband or your wife or your children or your parents or your brother or your sister or your friends. You're the one. You are going to decide your own eternal destiny. You're going to be among this innumerable number here mentioned in Revelation 7:9? Or are you going to be in the biggest prayer meeting that's ever been held, praying for the rocks and mountains to cover you up? The decision's up to you. Remember, the book of Revelation says, whoever wants to, let him take and drink of the water of life freely. Revelation 22:17. It is pointed out to the Apostle John, and he reveals it to us in the book of Revelation, in these visions that he had, that the things that are happening on this earth don't just happen all by themselves like people think. What's going on down here is actually being directed from up there, but people don't know it. They're going to find out one of these days. Let's look at just a few verses that show that there is a direct line of connection between earth and heaven, and that things going on down here are being directed from up there. Let's just look at a few verses. It's mentioned, by the way, over and over again in the book of Revelation. The 9th chapter. Verses 13 and 14. Then the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar. There's the golden altar again. Which is before God. Notice the golden altar is right in God's presence, like we were saying. Saying to the sixth angel who had the trumpet, release the four angels who are bound at the great river Euphrates. Verse 15. So the four angels who had been prepared for the hour and day and month and year were released to kill a third of mankind. Now, if you killed a third of mankind, would that seem to be a pretty significant event? And people think, well, we just had these wars. No. It doesn't just happen. It's somebody that's ordering events down here. We can't see it, so we don't understand it, but this book reveals that what's going on down here is actually being controlled from up there. Look at chapter 10. Verses 1 to 4, I saw still another mighty angel coming down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was on his head, and his voice was like the sun, and his feet like pillars of fire. And he had a little book open in his hand, and he set his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land, and cried with a loud voice as when a lion roars. And when he cried out, seven thunders uttered their voices. Now when the seven thunders uttered their voices, I was about to write, but I heard a voice from heaven saying to me, seal up the things which the seven thunders uttered, and do not write them. Here are some tremendous events that were going to happen in the world in the 19th century, and it wasn't God's will. It was all written down. It said, it's not time for the inhabitants of the world to know about this yet. Just seal that up. We found out what those seven thunders were in the 19th century, and not until. You cannot find out spiritual truth until God sees its time. And whether God sees its time or not in your situation depends on the condition of your heart. Is your heart in a condition so that God can show you what He wants to show you? Do
You see in these verses that there's an inseparable relation between the directives from the throne and tremendous activities that happen on the earth. And now let's go to something else that John has shown in these visions that is very remarkable. In chapter 11 of the book of Revelation, John is told, he says, remember, what is a central theme of the book? It's the temple of God and especially the throne of God. That's the central theme of the book. The temple is referred to at least 15 times, and the throne is referred to about 39 times. I want the children to count it up and tell me if that's the right number. Chapter 11, verse 1, then I was given a reed like a measuring rod, and the angel stood, saying, rise and measure the temple of God, the altar. Notice the altar's in the temple, and those who worship there. But then he's told the courtyard, that's on earth, the courtyard, which is the earth, leave out. Don't measure that. And then, as he envisioned, is taken down to in the stream of time, clear down to the time of the end, when the nations are angry, it says, and it's a time of judgment. You can read in verses 15 to 18. That's a time of the seventh trumpet. And the nations are angry, and it's the time of the dead that they should be judged. And now, what is the climax of this vision that he has? Look at the climax in verse 19. This is one of the more remarkable verses in the whole book of Revelation. Revelation 19, 11, 19. It says, then the temple of God. Notice, what was the central theme of the book of Revelation? The temple. And within the temple is the throne of God. And in this verse, it says the temple of God was what? It was open. And when it was open, then the prophet envisioned he could see into it when it was open. And when it was open so that he could see in, what did he see? What did he see? Notice, it says the ark. Now, we've already seen this temple. It has the candlesticks, just like the temple in the Old Covenant. It has the altar. The golden altar is referred to about eight times in the book of Revelation as being by the throne of God and the temple in heaven. But not only that, it doesn't have just the other furniture. In the temple on earth, the very center of the temple on earth was a second room, which was called the Holy of Holies, or the Most Holy Place. And in that room, there was a golden box called an ark. And in that ark, there was a covenant. A covenant that was written on stone. Let's read that. Look in your Bible in Deuteronomy 4:13. Says, so he declared to you his covenant, which he commanded you to perform, that is, the Ten Commandments. And he wrote them on two tablets of stone. And when the Ten Commandments were written on these two tablets of stone, what was Moses to do with those two tablets of stone? Go to chapter 10. We'll read verses 4 and 5. He wrote on the tablets, according to the first writing, the Ten Commandments, which the Lord had spoken to you on the mountain from the midst of the fire in the day of the assembly, and the Lord gave them to me. Then I turned and came down from the mountain and put the tablets in the ark, which I had made, and there they are, just as the Lord commanded me. But the Apostle Paul reveals to us in the book of Hebrews, we're not going to Hebrews, we're not just studying the book of Revelation right now. But in the book of Hebrews, the Apostle Paul shows us that everything that was in that earthly sanctuary was simply a type of the real sanctuary in heaven. And the Apostle John says, I saw it. It was opened up so I could see it. And when I looked into it, I saw the Ark of the Testament. I saw the Ark of the Covenant. Testament and covenant are interchangeable words. And the covenant, remember, is the Ten Commandments. Now, I want to be sure you understand this, what we're talking about very clearly, because this is important to understand. There are many Christians who don't understand this. The Ten Commandments that God wrote on tables of stone for the children of Israel and had put in the ark in the sanctuary, that was not the original of the Ten Commandments. That was a copy
of the Ten Commandments. That was not the original. The Ten Commandments didn't begin at Mount Sinai. For instance, the seventh commandment says you shall not commit adultery. Was it all right to commit adultery until you came up to Mount Sinai? Well, no. You read the book of Genesis. Everybody in the book of Genesis understood very clearly that it was wrong to commit adultery. And when the people in Sodom and Gomorrah didn't obey that commandment, God burned them down. They knew about it. The Ten Commandments that existed beforehand, the Ten Commandments, the original of the Ten Commandments, are these Ten Commandments mentioned here in Revelation 11:19. The Ark of the Covenant. What's the covenant? We read it in Deuteronomy 4:13. What's the covenant? The Ten Commandments. And the Ark containing the Ten Commandments, when the God's temple in heaven was opened up, so he could see right into the center where the throne of God is, right the control room of the universe, he saw there an Ark with Ten Commandments in it. You want to read something very interesting about this? Look in the book Early Writings. Ellen White in vision was shown the very same thing. She was shown in vision the original, the Ark, with the Ten Commandments inside. She saw it in vision. You can read that in the book Early Writings. John saw it here in vision. He writes about it here in Revelation 11:19. Now, we only have a few minutes left, and we have several important things to try to cover quickly. It is revealed to the Apostle John here in Revelation, especially in Revelation 12 to 14, but also in other parts of the book of Revelation, about not only Satan's brazen revolt against Christ and the defection of a third of the angels, that's Revelation 12, verse 4, and they're being cast out to the earth, but also the long and cruel war against the Christian church and against Christians in general is described in detail in the book of Revelation in several different places. Revelation 12 to 14 being a principal place. It was revealed to him that there would be a long and cruel war against the Christian church that would last for over 1,000 years. That's in Revelation 11 and 12 and 13. But in these visions that he has, he's carried down the stream of time through all of this awful period of tribulation and persecution that lasts for over 1,000 years. He's carried clear down to the end of that time, to that period of time that Daniel calls the time of the end. Most Bible writers call it the last days. Clear down to that period of time, and he's shown that in the last days, after this awful tribulation or persecution of Christians that will last for over 1,000 years, he's shown the fact that there will again be collusion between church and state. And that at the end of the world, this collusion between church and state will again attack Christ's followers right at the end. And you are shown that in detail in the last part of Revelation 13. And then he's shown God's response to this collusion of church and state, which will attack all of the followers of Christ right at the end of time. He's shown that God's response to this is to send the world during the last days a final message of mercy. And that final message of mercy is encapsulated in a triple message found in Revelation 14, 6 to 12. This is a message about the judgment hour, about Babylon's fall, and about a warning against receiving the mark of the beast. And the result of this message is, go to your Bible in Revelation 14, the result of this triple message is that there will be, in the very last days, a group of people that are described as follows in Revelation 14, 12. It says, here is the patience of the saints, here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus.
There will be a loyal remnant in the last days, according to this prophecy, who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Quick question. Will you be one of them? Will you be one of them? There's going to be a group of people like this. It says so. This is the prophecy in Revelation 14:12. It's going to happen. But will you be one of them? Those that reject the three angels' messages will then receive, at the end of the world, the seven last plagues. Let's read that. Look in Revelation 16. It says, the first went and poured out his bowl upon the earth, and a foul and loathsome sore came upon the men who had the mark of the beast and those that worshipped his image. Who is it that receives the seven last plagues? It's those that refuse and reject the three angels' messages. That's who receives the seven last plagues. Incidentally, we're not going to have time to go with this. But if you want to study it out from Revelation 15, these seven last plagues, the orders to give these seven last plagues come from no other place than from the throne room in the temple in heaven. That's where the orders come. Remember what I said? What happens in this earth doesn't just happen like people think. Things are being directed and controlled from up there. Read Revelation 15. You'll see that very clearly. The seven last plagues are ordered from the throne room of the temple in heaven.
But before these seven last plagues come and destroy a large part of the world's population,
because He's the God of infinite mercy and compassion,
in the wicked world that we're living in today, God is going to send one final invitation for mercy.
When you were a child, did you ever get so involved in your play that your mother called you for supper and you were so absorbed that you were trying to finish what you were doing, and pretty soon she calls you again? Did you ever get so involved in your play that finally your mother said, it's the last call if you want supper? You ever had that experience? Well, this is the last call. If you don't get this one, you will be lost. This is the last call that comes from the God of heaven to the people of this world. Here is in Revelation 18 chapter. In Revelation 17, he's shown the depth of the ecclesiastical apostasy that's aided and abetted by the nations, and that has brought all the terror during the Christian era. That's all reviewed in chapter 17. But then God takes an overruling hand and directs an angel to come down from heaven, from the throne room. And it says that this angel, Revelation 18, he cried mightily with a loud voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, is fallen. He describes a terrible condition that has happened in the religious world, all over the world. That's in verses 2 and 3. And then in verse 4, notice, direct from heaven, from the throne room, there comes a voice. Listen to what it says. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins, unless you receive her plague. Do you realize, friends, that most of God's children are in all kinds of organizations today that are all mixed up in apostasy of all kinds and are not following the Bible at all? But most of God's children are there. That God is going to take His children out of there.
There's coming a time, friend, when however long you've been in a Babylonian situation, if you want to be saved, you're going to have to be willing to get out.
There came a time when Noah's building the ark. You could watch him build the ark for 120 years, but there came a time when it was the last call if you wanted to get off. That's what this is. This is the last call. If you don't make this one, you don't get this. If you don't respond this time, be all over. Well, I've preached so long, we're out of time. I don't have time to cover the final events, which are described in more detail in Revelation than almost any other book of the Bible. The final events of Christ coming back to this earth a second time, described in detail in Revelation, the 19th chapter. And then what happens next in Revelation, the 20th chapter. But I want to close with a thought question. Not going to answer this one. You're going to have to figure this out for yourself. Remember, a major theme of the whole book of Revelation is what? The temple of God, and especially the throne of God in that temple. That's a major theme. Remember, he refers to the throne of God almost 40 times. And he describes the temple at least 15 times, and he talks about the general environment of the throne room almost 20 times. This is a major theme of the book of Revelation. But now here we're going to close. Now here we're going to read a text, and I'm going to leave this for you to figure out. You're going to have to figure this one out without me. You ready for it? You ready for a quiz? Okay, here it is. I can just guarantee you some of you are going to have to study to figure this out. This has been a major theme of the whole book. Now notice what he says in Revelation 21. Revelation 21. 22. I saw no temple. Now that's what he's been talking about all through the whole book. That's been a major theme of the book. But now he says, I saw no temple in it, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are his temple. So why is it that there's no need of a temple anymore? Well, that's going to be for you to figure out. Now I'm over time already, and I have something I want to read to you in closing. If you'll allow me, I'll try to read it as fast as I can. But this is a fitting conclusion to what we've been studying about the book of Revelation. The world is a theater. The actors, its inhabitants, are preparing to act their part in the last great drama. God is lost sight of. With the great masses of mankind, there is no unity except as men confederate to accomplish their selfish purposes. God is looking on. His purposes in regard to his rebellious subjects will be fulfilled. The world has not been given into the hands of men, though God is permitting the elements of confusion and disorder to bear sway for a season. A power from beneath is working to bring about the last scenes in the drama, Satan coming as Christ and working with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in those who are binding themselves together in secret societies. Those who are yielding to the passion for confederation are working out the plans of the enemy. The cause will be followed by the effect. Oh, friend, if you study the book of Revelation, if we would all make a diligent study of the book of Revelation, we would have a revival that we have not seen yet. Would you like to have a revival like that and be ready for Jesus to come? Let's pray for his hand towards himself. Father in heaven, we thank you that this world has not been given into the hands of men. We thank you for the knowledge that we have just read in the book of Revelation, that there is an overruling, overseeing providence, that although the forces of disorderliness and rebellion have been allowed to bear sway for a season, that a great master plan is about to be worked out. And Lord, in that great day, and our Lord and Savior descends from heaven to receive his own and to destroy a wicked world, we humbly but earnestly pray that each of us here may be ready to meet him. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things. Who brings out their host by number? He calls them all by name. By the greatness of his might and the strength of his power, not one is missing. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be above all the earth.